Hello everybody, welcome back to my channel where skincare is all about progression over perfection because perfection doesn't exist. Today I have some ugly news for you. These are stories that I couldn't really stretch into a full length episode of When Beauty Turns Ugly, but still some interesting beauty related stories that I wanted to share with you. Whilst I do my skincare routine, first of all, I've already cleansed with, I don't know, whatever was in the shower, can't remember. So I'm going to go in with an essence. This is the Miguhara Vegan Skin Relief Soothing Essencer. I believe this is like aloe and panthenolin. To be honest with you, I can't really remember, but it's just really nice and hydrating and calming for my skin. So let's start off with how Boots here in the UK try to sabotage the launch of Sephora UK. So for those who don't know, Boots is almost like a CVS, I guess is the closest. Oh no, Robert always compares it to a Walgreens. So it's somewhere where you have like a pharmacy, but you could also get you could also get like a meal deal, and you can get like hairspray, toiletries, you know, all that kind of stuff. And I would say they are one of the go-to kind of like beauty shops on the high street, because if you need something, you just pop into Boots real quick and see if they have it, because they are everywhere. But with the launch of a physical Sephora store here in the UK, it sounds like they panicked a little bit. The physical Sephora store is in Westfield in White City, which is in London. And it seems to be a massive success so far. I went to the opening, absolutely loved it, loved it. There's everything that you expect a Sephora to have, like brands that you could only usually get in America, here in the UK. As I mentioned before, Sephora, you only really had Boots. You have Space NK, which is amazing. But Boots in particular had started to make a real effort in trying to become a bit more of like a beauty haul. You know, trying to almost become the UK's equivalent of Sephora, they started to stock brands like Kylie Skin, Dr. Jart, and even MAC to make their stores look a bit more, as I mentioned, like a beauty store rather than a pharmacy. However, recently Boots CEO Seb James admitted to Retail Week Live that he and his team plotted to make Sephora's store launch a failure, despite actually benefiting from a boom in sales on the day of the Sephora store launch in Westfield. He says to Retail Week Live, "Our whole team lent into the idea of making that launch a disaster, but says as a result, a whole flock of new customers came to Boots. We grew 85% in a year, and the general message going around the store was up yours, Sephora, and it felt very, very good." Good for them. He didn't really elaborate, however, on what the big plan was to sabotage Sephora UK. However, according to a Retail Gazette, they did pay for a huge billboard outside Westfield, and I do remember seeing it. I remember seeing an amazing Space NK one, huge, and a not-so-big Boots one. But the Boots one, they did describe themselves as your number one destination for beauty. So maybe that was the plan? I don't know if billboards really do anything anymore. I don't know. Boots also tried to revamp their Westfield store. They didn't try to, they physically did it. And held a launch party to clash with the Sephora launch. So honestly, it just sounded like they had a bit of a store revamp and put some posters up, which great for them, but it's less sabotage. Honestly, just sound like a bit of British banter, to be honest with you. I'm gonna go with a serum. I'm gonna be using the Glow Recipe Watermelon Niacinamide Dew Drops. It's been a while, and I wanna go back to one of my faves. Bit of niacinamide. I feel like I've been sick recently. I don't know if you can hear it in my voice. I'm still a bit like bunged up, but I just also wanna look a bit dewier. My skin's always very dry when I'm ill. If you follow me on Twitter, we've probably had a little discussion about this already, but Levi's have decided to fake their way to diversity. In a tweet from peterpixel.com, I think it's how you pronounce it, they announced that Levi will be using AI-generated models in order to increase diversity across their website. This will be a collab with La La Land AI, who creates AI models with a goal of making the fashion industry more diverse and sustainable, and to give fashion brands and retailers the ability to create hyper-realistic models of every body type, age, size, and skin tone. Now, this startup was co-founded in 2019 by Michael Masandu and Eugenius Rimzer. Agnes? And from the very limited information that I could find on these two, Michael was South African and Eugenius? I've never heard that name before, is from Amsterdam. So one black man and one white man. And it's important to tell you that because AI created diversity brings up a lot of conversation about how diversity really works. So Levi said the following about their latest idea. They say, "We believe our models should reflect our consumers, which is why we're continuing to diversify our human models in terms of size, body type, age, and skin color." Then goes on to explain that working with real people isn't enough to meet these goals. So they go on to say that the idea is that, so this partnership with La La Land AI is supposedly supposed to help them kind of meet the goals of having a diverse set of models for each item of clothing, so that when a customer clicks on an item of clothing, they are able to see what somebody of their race, gender, a diverse group will look like in that item of clothing. Did I explain that okay? I think that makes sense, right? They say which would create a more personal and inclusive shopping experience. But here's the issue, I would say 90% of people had in the replies to this tweet, to the news, this is a lazy way to diversify. It is, it's lazy. The whole point of diversity in the fashion world in particular here, let's talk about, and the beauty world, is to include those of different social and ethnic backgrounds, different genders, sexual orientations, diverse groups, so that those people from those groups can look at somebody, right, and can see themselves in them, can relate, can see themselves in a campaign. Now, let me know what you think, but I don't think AI models are the best way of doing that. Creating fake humans to tick certain boxes of diversity feels extremely lazy to me and kind of almost like fake diversity. I doubt that anybody will look at an AI model and be like, oh my God, I can relate to this person. Including white models, they aren't relatable in any way because they're not real. No one relates to them. No one's like, oh, that's cool. I mean, people look at it and think, oh, thank God there's a fake model that looks like me or my skin color. And also, rather than actual diverse models earning a living wage from these modeling jobs, it will be the two CEOs of the company reaping these rewards of this fake diversity. Because should this white man be benefiting, reaping the rewards of like creating black models? Should either of them be reaping the rewards of, you know, using Asian models, models in wheelchairs? And they're saying that using these AI models will allow people of all these backgrounds to see themselves in this campaign and that it's a realistic way of doing it. Listen, I think that's bullshit. I call bullshit on that. I honestly think it's just laziness. When I used to work for ASOS, right, we were told at the time that ASOS would get in roughly 100 new items a day. Yes, that could be anything from socks to outerwear, you know? But all of this needed to be photographed mainly on models and uploaded onto the website. At the time, retouched, they don't retouch anymore, but it had to be shot on a model, retouched, uploaded, you know, linked to a SKU. ASOS have their own in-house studios and these models would work on like a carousel, one in, one out. Shoot, 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 pose, pose, pose. And it would be like that for a day. And they would shoot hundreds of items on, I guess like at the time, 20 to 30 different models a day. And it worked and they still do it to this day. I believe they have more models than that now. Levi, who have significantly less items of clothing and a much higher net worth, are very much capable of hiring a set diverse team of models and photographing them in each item with a quick turnaround. Okay, next up, I'm going to use a glow recipe, Guava Vitamin C Bright Eye Gel Cream. Again, this is a product that has long-term benefits as far as hydrating under the eye, discoloration, helping, you know, hydrate and plump, but also has these immediate benefits of like a bit of a sheen, a bit of a glow. So it makes your under eyes look a lot more awake than they actually are. The next one I was tagged in a lot, and this is France's new laws on filters. So here in the UK, the Advertising Standards Authority back in 2021 ruled that influencers could not use misleading filters in paid partnerships, in particular in beauty ads. And they actually took action against a load of influencers who were using filters and doing undisclosed ads at the time. They've not really put their foot down that much recently. And now France could actually be following in the UK's footsteps. Now France's finance minister, Bruno Le Maire, said that the country is the first European nation to create a comprehensive framework for regulating the influencer sector. I'm not sure that's 100% accurate, but I'm glad they have one. That's great. He goes on to say that they will make it mandatory to display the use of a filter or retouching on a photo and video content during a paid, explaining that they sought to limit the destructive psychological effects that the practices had on internet users, adding that any promotion concerning cosmetic surgery by an influencer as part of paid partnership will now be prohibited altogether, sending out a warning to influencers who do not respect the law, saying that the government will not be lenient. I mean, that's great. That's really, really good. I mean, I kind of wish I don't know whether it's just the way it's worded, but saying that they'll make it mandatory to display the use of a filter or retouching on photo and video content during a paid partnership, it just shouldn't be allowed at all. I mean, this is definitely one step further, but there should be no retouching and no filters on paid partnerships or advertising. And really that comes down to the brands abiding by this kind of law and making sure that this law is being held accountable. And make sure that people are following this law. But listen, I have a lot of trust in France for this kind of stuff, because this comes after they passed a law in 2017 saying that basically all commercial adverts with retouched models should be clearly labeled with retouched photo. They are one of the first countries to do that. In this case, France are ahead of the times, and I'm surprised, honestly, that it's taken any country this long to do this. I still feel like a lot of countries have a lot of catching up to do, but there does seem to be so much leniency still nowadays for retouched commercial photos versus influencers using filters. And it's kind of unfair. No one should be allowed to do it. But I feel like when it comes to TV adverts, perfume adverts, mascara adverts, foundation adverts on the TV and in print, there's just so much leniency because it seems to be so engraved in everyone's culture that by default, that's going to be retouched in some way. You know, that's just how the beauty and fashion industry works. And I feel like that's how, not that I agree with it, but that's how I kind of feel everyone is kind of like, oh, you know, you expect it nowadays. The UK and Norway so far are the only two countries to have this ban in full swing, whilst France and Germany will hopefully be added to that list soon. Next up, a moisturizer. I'm going to use my Stura Atto Barrier 365 cream. I love this. It's just great for my skin barrier and moisturizing. This is honestly like my default evening moisturizer. Why am I putting it on like this? That's weird. Next up, does anyone care? Kim Kardashian files trademark for daughter Northwest on own skincare line, excuse me. Kim Kardashian has four trademarks under her daughter's name, under Northwest's name. The first one, though, has been a trademark for skincare, body care, fragrances, cosmetics, body serums, body gels, and body oils, along with a trademark for toys and clothing, and a trademark for entertainment. I don't know what that means. And really, this comes after the success of North's TikTok account, which was banned for a little bit, wasn't it? It was taken down for a little bit. It seems to be back up now. This TikTok account, Kim and North, has over 15 million followers as of filming this video. And listen, I have a feeling she won't be releasing a skincare line for kids anytime soon. I mean, I think there's limits for kids, right? Bath products, great. Moisturizers, yes, some kids can get like dry skin. But I do hope we're not going to be seeing body serums and oils for kids. Toys, I get, but I honestly think this is more future-proofing Northwest's future more than anything. Future-proofing her future, yeah. That's even if the Kardashian-Jenner kingdom is even relevant in years to come. People seem to be less into the Kardashians now more than ever. And their downfall rumors come from a few things. Their non-invite to the Met Gala, which doesn't mean they're not going. Designers can still invite them. I probably think they are going to be in there, but actually none of them made the top five of Gen Z's top influencer list. Kylie was at number 10 and Kim was at number 7. And it does appear that they're trying to be a lot more like real nowadays, a lot more candid. Like this odd post of Khloe Kardashian in what appears to be in a 2019 new build in Surrey. Like why is this so English? It's so strange. Like they're about to pop out to Weatherspoons and then Liquid, you know? It's so strange to me. Does anybody know where this is? Let me know, because it just looks so English. Okay, lip balm. I'm going to be using Naturium's Phyto Glow Lip Balm. Again, a really nice general lip balm to kind of like help my lips feel nicely moisturized. You can apply it a little bit thicker if you want a night mask, but it also has slight tint to it. Again, just making me look a lot healthier than I'm feeling right now. It's very buildable. If you want a shiny lip, you can have one. If you want to use it as a light mask, you can do that too. Moving on, Gwyneth Paltrow's ski crash trial has been good for Goop. Not the most loved skincare brand here, old person, I'll be honest with you. Google searches for her brand have risen by 195%. I'm not going to go into the whole trial. Go and watch it. Basically, someone skied into the back of her, and he was trying to sue her for a lot of money when it wasn't her fault. She countersued for $1 and won. However, during this trial, as I mentioned, Google searches for Goop skyrocketed to 195% worldwide just hours after Paltrow won her case. And this comes from Analysis Japan 101. Influencer content mentioning Goop across all social media platforms also soared 60%, while engagement increased 382%. 226% of boost in influencers mentioning Gwyneth Paltrow, as well as a 644% increase in engagements and a 4,714% boost in all video views. However, this boom in figures isn't always positive. This could be down to things like people using her name for content to bring up her terrible brand, for example, the lawsuits tied in with Goop, her awful Netflix documentary, her vagina egg. It doesn't mean that everyone suddenly wants to buy a Goop candle that explodes, apparently, according to a lawsuit. But also not everyone thinks that these searches are purely coming from her trial. Leading up to the trial, she appeared on a podcast called The Art of Being Well, and this went viral after sharing her wellness insights, and most notably her diet, which a lot of people had a lot of negative things to say about. I'm not going to go into it a lot. Trigger warning about food. She doesn't eat a lot, and it's kind of scary. So Analysis Japan 101 say it's kind of hard to dictate which cultural moments are having the biggest impact. Going to finish on a fragrance. This is the Kaali Yum Pistachio Gelato. I love this. I bought it purely because their influencer marketing was good. I saw everybody using this. And I wanted to try it, and it's really nice. Hazelnut, sweet rum, whipped cream, marshmallow, cotton candy. We know I'm not the best at describing fragrance, but if you are into your muskier fragrances but want to try something a little bit sweeter for the summer, this is a nice one to go for. Very, very nice. Now, finally, no more binning skincare before getting on flight. No more trying to stuff all your cosmetics into a mini sandwich bag. London City Airport has become the first major UK airport to abandon the 100 milliliter liquid carry-on rules, according to Bloomberg.com. The airport said the passengers will also no longer have to limit toiletries and liquids to 100 milliliters or put them in clear plastic bags. Now, if you don't remember why we even do this, this goes back to 2006, after British police discovered a terror plot to detonate liquid explosives mid-air. They planned to smuggle these liquid explosives disguised as soft drinks in their hand luggage, and it said that this could have been one of the deadliest terror attacks since 9/11. According to the Telegraph, but luckily they were all stopped on their tracks to their flights. Essentially meaning now we can take full-size beauty products onto a plane, which I feel is unnecessary anyway. I'm sure we're all kind of used to getting minis or even doing our skincare before we get on a plane. But basically you can take your full size on and not have them thrown away because they don't fit in a certain size sandwich bag. But why? Why now? Because this is still slightly terrifying to me. Like, the idea of that is still terrifying. Well, the Telegraph say that a new and innovative technology has allowed for the rules to be eased, with the UK government requiring all UK airports to use the tech by June 2024, making travel even easier, allowing its resurgence after the pandemic. But yes, I want to know more about this tech because it still scares me. I want to know what exactly this tech does. I'm sure I can find out somewhere. But yeah, no more binning your favorite hand cream. You might be taking Essence on board for some reason. Speaking of hand cream, actually, I am going to use the CeraVe hand cream. I don't know. It was cheap and good. So there we have it for ugly news today. Let me know your opinion on any of these stories. Any other beauty-related stories that you think we all may be interested in, let me know in the comments down below. You can watch the whole When Beauty Turns Ugly playlist here. Some general light entertainment here, and I'll see you over there.